to today. Our speaker today is a freelance writer specializing in true crime. To research his first book, Cause of Death, he volunteered in a county morgue, watching as his co-author, Kent County Chief Medical Examiner, Dr. Stephen D. Cole, unraveled puzzling forensic mysteries. A second collaboration with Dr. Cole resulted in his book, Skeletons in the Closet. His love of history and fascination with true crime led to True Crime Michigan, True Crime in the Civil War, The Shocking Case of Helmut Schmidt, and Strychnine Saint. Today, he will share with us some of the stories of 20th century crimes that took place in Michigan. Please help me welcome Tobin Hook.
Good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me okay? I got more wires on me. I can fly to the moon. I need just a jetpack. Thank you, first and foremost, for having me here to speak about something that I've been doing for quite some time, researching various criminal cases. A lot of the stuff took place in Michigan, some other stuff in other places. Today I'm going to focus primarily on three cases that may be familiar to you. So I am otherwise known as Dark Corners of History, which is a website that I've started, and if you have a chance, you might want to check it out. It's where I delve into some of the darker facets of history, not just Michigan history, but elsewhere. When I'm not writing true crime, I am a middle school teacher and a high school teacher, so I'm in, you might say, a crime scene every day. Don't worry, I could talk about real graphic stuff. I've been there, I've seen it, I've had my gloves bloody. But I'm not going to talk about anything that's going to make you lose your lunch. So the cases that I write about are things that are not easily Googled, and they're very, very complicated. And I have a tendency to run on and ramble a bit when I talk about this stuff because I'm quite passionate about it, which is a bit strange. My wife thinks I have a dark side. And and she's probably right. I think that what happens is crime writers and criminals are different sides of the same coin. And the coin came up crime writer for me, which is good. Yeah, that's good. Right. Although every now and again I give a presentation like this, somebody asks me, well, how can I commit a crime and get away with it? And it's like, I don't want to answer that. So anyways, I spent a year volunteering in the Kent County Morgue. I went down every other Saturday as research to write my first two books, which were collaborations with the Kent County Medical Examiner. And I've seen things that, frankly, I wish I could sort of unsee. The worst that people have done could do to one another. And I discovered that the truth is indeed stranger than fiction. And if you want me to regale you with some of those stories, I'd be happy to do it afterward. But some of that stuff's pretty intensely gross, and I don't want you to lose your lunch. So it's nice to be in a room with all women. I know there are a few gentlemen, and I think I counted six, so we are indeed lucky to be in this scenario. I am used to that. I have a wife of 22. I live with four women. I have a wife of 22 years. Yay. How often do you hear that today? I have two daughters, Erica, 14, who's nearing dateable age. Eek! Yeah, I'm going to need it. I have a younger daughter, Victoria, who's 11, and then I have a 10-month-old redhead named Rosie, who is a standard poodle. So I live in a household of all women, so although I do find it mildly intimidating to be with 60 of you, but we'll work it out. Behind me is a table of contents. The cases that I'm going to talk about are so over-the-top complex, and I don't want to ramble on and keep you all day long in this beautiful day. So I'm going to go over this stuff fairly quickly, and then I'm going to take some time and go over the last three cases in some detail. And then we'll have some time for questions and answers, and meet and greet, and if you want to buy copies of books, I brought copies of the five historical books for you to take a look at. I thought you'd like to take a look at a gallery of fiends, some of the things that I've written about. I drove on my way here, MapQuest directions, ooh, I tell you, they don't tell you about construction. I drove through Royal Oak, I think, to get here, and the story of Helmut Schmidt took place in Royal Oak, and I call him Michigan's original Lonely Hearts Killer because he's the first of three that share a shockingly similar modus operandi. They were predators who troweled for victims through matrimonial advertisements. The first one in Michigan, I think that fits this MO, is Helmut Schmidt. This is he also moonlighted as a World War I spy. He worked for Ford's Highland Park plant. This is probably the most twisted and bizarre case. I mean, it took me months just to get through the timeline of this particular case. Now, if Detroiters knew their history, then they would have avoided Harry Powers, who was the second matrimonial advertisement killer from Indiana. And if they knew their history, they would have stayed away from Raymond Fernandez, who is half of what is called the Lonely Hearts duo. And that's a case I'll talk about in great detail. Another Michigan fiend that you probably have never heard of is Mrs. Mary McKnight. Sometimes she's referred to as Mrs. Mary Murphy McKnight. She lived in Fife Lake, and she poisoned her victims with a heavy metal called strychnine, which is really hard to understand because strychnine kills with a signature that is so specific there's only one other natural malady that could pass for it, and that would be tetanus. Except tetanus kills very slowly and strychnine kills real fast like that. She killed an entire branch of her family, brother, brother's wife, and infant daughter. And then she, and when I laid out the family tree, she had essentially killed one child in every one of her siblings' families and made an attempt on one in another family. I'm convinced that she, when the dust settled, she killed about a dozen people. And I know some individuals who think that that would make her one of America's worst female serial killers. That's a tough claim. But there's a lot to this case. And she's a very early example of what you might call an angel of mercy style killer, a caregiver. She was a midwife who, instead of taking care of people, killed them. This happens for a variety of reasons. Profit or motive is one of them. It wasn't her motive, but if you really want to take a look at what went on in the mind of Mary McKnight, you should check out the book. It's very fascinating. I think she's an early example of a substance abuser, and I think the substance abuse had something to do with it. Back then, people could take all kinds of substances. Paregoric was one, which is a very powerful alcohol-opium combination. They could get heroin. Early soda pops had cocaine in them, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Heyer's Root Beer, which I didn't know, just found that out recently. And this was legal until like 1914. The Pure Food and Drug Act of 1906, they started to regulate it, and then in 1914, they kind of started to ban it. Substance abuse combined with a real heavy case of depression will cause a skewed sense of what reality is. And that's what I think happened with Mary McKnight. So enough on that one. My latest book is just a deliciously twisted, I wanted to call it Twisted Fairy Tale. It involves a get rich scheme by the fellow on the upper left-hand corner. His name was Arthur Warren Waite. And to all the world, he was an Adonis, a perfect man, a boy next door, athlete, tennis player, championship tennis player, football player, baseball player, University of Michigan graduate from the dental school, went to South Africa, practiced dentistry, came back and set up a dental surgery in New York, and started to court the daughter of one of the wealthiest families in Grand Rapids and in Michigan, the Peck family, and in 1916, their wealth was eclipsed seven figures. So we're talking about a lot of coin. Turns out that Arthur Warren Waite, although he looked like a really good-looking guy, physically, was actually devious, and he had hatched an immediate plan to wipe out the entire family so he could inherit his wife's money. And it's an ingenious plot. He was going to douse their soup with germs, viruses, diphtheria, typhus, typhoid, pneumococcus, influenza. And that's an ingenious plot because an autopsy of someone who dies of influenza will find nothing but a natural cause of death. Unfortunately, the apartment where they were living on, and it's a bizarre story, the apartment they were living in didn't have, he couldn't preserve the germs. They weren't virulent enough, so he turned to the old tried and true, the second heavy metal poisoning called arsenic. And I was just asked this on a television interview the other day, why do poisoners choose arsenic, or historically, why have they? It's because it presents itself with symptoms that are very similar to other things, diarrhea, vomiting. And before 1916, embalmers used it to embalm a body. And what they typically did is they made an incision here in the arm and pumped in the embalming fluid. Then they used something called a trocar, made an incision here, allowed the gas to leave, and pumped in more embalming fluid. If they weren't real careful, and why did they need to be? The victims were dead, right? They pierced the stomach, and arsenic would get into the internal organs. And so what this did is it gave poisoners a forensic alibi. They could always say, well, the arsenic got into the system because of the embalmers. By 1916, this was illegal everywhere in the United States, and that is why. Also by 1916, they could tell whether a person had ingested arsenic before or after death by doing an autopsy of the brain. Wade, of course, knew this, so he tried to get his victims cremated. And he was successful in getting the first victim cremated. Female intuition, something I suppose you appreciate, led to his downfall. A friend of the family got curious about some circumstances and wired a telegram pseudonymously under the name Kay Adams, which, by the way, is the name of a victim in New York State's most famous poisoning case, saying, don't cremate the body, have an autopsy. And then the plot, they found that Arthur Warren Waite was a sham. He wasn't practicing dentistry at all, which is kind of interesting. Now, a little bit more on Mary McKnight. If you go up to Fife Lake and you go into the Springfield Township Cemetery, you're going to see this tombstone, Mary McKnight. And it's interesting, people would think that someone with my background would spend a whole lot of time poking around cemeteries, but I don't really like to be honest with you. I find it a little bit morbid even for me. But there are people, when I wrote this book, there was a bit of a run on the cemetery, and everybody wanted to go see this grave. What you're not going to know is that this grave contains two victims, all right, because they were killed an hour apart. The child, Ruth Murphy, was killed first with strychnine. And then while the dad was off in Fife Lake getting a coffin, the mother of the daughter was left in the care of Aunt Mary McKnight, and she poisoned Gertrude. And so the two were buried in classic Irish-style wake with child in mother's arms. And you don't see that reflected on the tombstone, which is kind of interesting. I do a lot of genealogical type research to get to the bottom of my characters, and sometimes you run into these dead ends. No pun intended. I'll tell you an interesting one. When I wrote The Shocking Case of Helmuth Schmidt, I wanted to go and see the grave. I know I just said I don't like to hang out in cemeteries, but I wrote the book on the guy. I wanted to go see where he was interred. So I had a news article that said that he was buried in a place. I'm going from memory now. I think it was Forest Lawn Cemetery. Okay, and I called down there and got a real nice lady on the phone. And I wanted to know where the grave was. And I told her, I'm going to come by, you know, and I'd like to just take a look and see. And could you just tell me where I should look? She looked through her book and she said, there's nobody here by that name. And this was just the latest in a series of dead ends that I had run into, and I was just very frustrated. She said, she told me there's another cemetery with a similar name across town. It's older. Maybe they have them. And so I hung up the phone, and not 5 minutes later, the phone rang, and it was this lady from this Forest Lawn Cemetery. She said, I found your guy. She said, he's in the other cemetery book. Wow, a hidden cemetery within a cemetery. How cool is that? I think, you know, the wheels start turning, right? Thinking, wow, this is a good plot for a novel, right? It turns out that they have a second set of cemetery records for unmarked graves. And Helmuth Schmidt's grave is unmarked. So you could go looking all you wanted to and you won't find him. You can find the plot of land. And what's really interesting is she told me that his neighbors in the cemetery are a group of Civil War soldiers who are all buried in the same grave. It's a mass grave, unmarked. And I found that to be fascinating because I ran into a lot of those kind of dead ends when I wrote True Crime in the Civil War. And it's a bit of a cautionary tale because if you had an ancestor who died in the Civil War, you could go looking for a grave and you might never find it because he's sitting in a mass grave in Forest Lawn Cemetery someplace. So it's just fascinating. I had a real interesting conversation with the lady about the different stories that these cemeteries could tell if they could speak. This is an original document from the guy who sold the coffin to John Murphy, and it's an interesting expense. It's a casket for the wife and the child. John Murphy was charged $38 for this casket. 10 days later, you got it, John Murphy died. Also after being cared for by his sister. And one by one, the tumbler started to open and Mary McKnight became the Michigan Borgia, which is a reference to Lucretia Borgia of Renaissance fame. Right. It's actually sort of an insult to Lucretia Borgia, from what I understand, because a lot of her poisonings were essentially sort of not really factual. Here's Arthur, here is John Peck, the Michigan millionaire who was poisoned by his son-in-law, Arthur Warren Waite. And it's a classic tale of a guy, a kid from the other side of the tracks who makes good, marries the millionaire's daughter, but where it gets twisted is he decides that he's going to inherit her money by killing mom, dad, and then eventually he started to poison his wife too. When they ran a blood test, they found typhoid in her system, so she was going to be the next victim. That's what the mom looked like. Mom went first. Actually, he experimented. I mean, until this guy was really something. He experimented with his aunt first. He fed her marmalade spiked with glass chips. He fed her some food that was spiked with feces, and I don't know where that came from, and all kinds of other things. And he was going to go with arsenic when Hannah Peck decided to come to town. And so he immediately changed his attention to her. And she was cremated, so it's hard to know exactly what caused her death, but they found a significant quantity of cocaine in Waite's apartment, and her pupils were dilated before she died, and that's one of the symptoms of a cocaine overdose. John Peck went next, and that's Arthur Warren Waite. Okay, good-looking man. I don't know. I'm going to talk a little bit about John Norman Collins today, the co-ed killer. Good-looking guy. And it's interesting, I was asked, why would people find a case like this poisoning the Pecks interesting? And one of my comments on that was, here's the boy next door. Makes you wonder about the boy next door to you, doesn't it? And again, like I said, my daughter is nearing dateable age, and this type of thing make you darn near paranoid. Yeah. So she brings an Adonis home to see daddy, and I'm thinking, why? Well, you know. That was the wife, Clara, who was a dupe in all of this. And it was discovered that her husband was living, the duplicity is just very thick. He was living two different lives. He told her he was going off during the day to practice dental surgery, and he wasn't. He was spending time in the Plaza Hotel with that woman under the name Dr. A.W. Walters. All right. And in fact, she was a married cabaret singer by the name of Margaret Horton. And very interesting, she was married to a guy who would later become a war hero, Harry Mack Horton, and buried in Arlington Cemetery. And Harry tried to stand by his wife because she and Arthur Warren Waite did everything they could to try to tell the world that their relationship was platonic, but come on. You know, they're in the hotel every day together. They found his bedclothes there. Had an interesting communication from descendants of Harry Mack Horton, and they had no idea that this woman even existed. This was a secret that was sort of shoved under the carpet by the family. And I've had, with some of the three books here, the serial killer books especially, I've had conversations with descendants. And more than every single instance, it's been very positive. But I've known more than they did about their family ancestry, which puts me in a little bit of a surreal situation. And I think you go back far enough and people just don't want to know this type of thing. I tell you, on my mom's side of the family, my great grandmother was a bootlegger in Kansas, made very fine whiskey, and my grandfather Louis, his job as a little boy, whenever there was a raid, was to take the pieces of the still and get it out to the cornfield. And so I asked Grandpa, why? How did you know there was a raid coming? He said because your great grandmother's best client was a judge, right? It's prohibition for you. Right, and I'll tell you that story, and I'll tell you that he had a sister who shot a guy who basically ran an inn, a bar, and she was hobnobbing with some gangsters. One guy shot another guy because he was being too loud, that type of thing. And it's like street credibility for a crime writer. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, I'm on the left hand side of my family tree. I've got this, but you go back far enough, and people don't maybe want to know this. So here's another picture of her studio. She was a aspiring actress, and what really killed her career, I think, is probably a lack of talent, and the fact that when she did get some gigs, they always billed her as Margaret Horton of the Waite case, right? So all of a sudden, her notoriety was essentially what was getting her these gigs, and you know, they panned her real bad. Another picture of her, and what they did, and this is very typical of newspapers of the era, this is 1916, is they put the pictures up, and notice the shaping of the pictures, they form a love triangle. Do you see? You know, and you look at these newspapers. This one's from the Library of Congress, and you look at newspapers from this era that have pictures like this, and they'll always be arranged in a triangle like that. It's kind of fascinating. thought that we could just walk on the dark side of yesterday a little bit real quick before I get into the major cases. One of the things that I have to be very cognizant of when I write historic crime is the idea that the way things happened then are not the way they happen today. Okay, a good example of this is your right to a defense attorney. That is a relatively modern concept. If you go back into the mid-1800s, mid to late 1800s, you didn't have a right to a defense attorney. You had a right to defend yourself. If you couldn't afford a defense attorney, then you defended yourself. Today, of course, if you can't afford one, then you'll get a court-appointed attorney. Now, during the United States Civil War, the Union military sat in judgment of a lot of civilian cases if they took place in Union-occupied territory. And Union military courts were even better than civilian courts because you were guaranteed a defense attorney even if you couldn't afford one. But get this, the defense attorney was also the prosecuting attorney. Okay? All right? The judge advocate general presented the case for the prosecution, and then when he was done, he flipped and he presented the case on the side of the defense. Yeah. Things very, very different. And of course, back then, these were line officers and they were considered to be impartial discoverers of the truth beyond scrutiny. But of course, we know that that's not entirely the way it is. There are some cases in the United States Civil War, one I write about in that book in particular, where there's a question as to whether the trial actually existed. And I found documentary evidence, get this one, that the death order, the execution order, was dated a day before the trial order. So a general signed the execution warrant before he ordered the trial to take place. There's quite a bit more to that. Now, over time, as I go through this, I wind up acquiring quite a bit of ephemera related to crime that I like to use to illustrate my books. And my website, Dark Corners of History, I probe some of this stuff. And this one is a wanted poster for an individual named Willard T. Guy, who you see the crime that he is guilty of. Wife abandonment, which is a crime today. It's not vigorously prosecuted. It's like swearing. You know, you don't really have a legal right to say whatever you want whenever you want. But it's, can you imagine in my middle school what would happen if they started prosecuting swearing? I mean, they'd be taking kids away in cuffs left and right, you know, or fining people. I've got a document someplace from 1835 where a judge fined a guy $1 for swearing, profane language, as part of a bar fight, I think. And so today, spousal abandonment is a crime, but it's not as prosecuted as it was back here in 1919, because today, theoretically speaking, women and men stand on a level playing field as far as employability is concerned. If you go back far enough, you have only so many occupations that are really open to women. And there are situations where women were completely dependent on their men. And so when Willard Guy walked away from his wife in 1919, he left her, Irene, completely destitute. And so if you look at the last line, and this is Highland Park, Michigan, we're eagerly looking for this man. The way things are back then, much different than they are today. Now, interestingly enough, I poked around a little bit of some city guides, and I found a 1920 city guide that lists Irene and Willard Guy as if they had never separated in the first place. And so they either reconciled their differences, or she just didn't want anybody to know that she was abandoned. Here's another one. This one is from the city of Detroit. I think he's wanted on a charge of larceny. I'm sorry you can't see, the text isn't real large, but there's a line here that I like very much. It says down here, this man may be found around cabarets as he is very fond of women. Now, what you're not gonna see here, which is fairly interesting, is you're not going to see fingerprints. Because when this poster came out, this is 1917, May, local municipalities hadn't started using fingerprints. The state police did, but the local Detroit hadn't used them really until 1918, 1919. So they used a series of measurements, and my French isn't very good, but they're called Bertillon measurements. Alphonse Bertillon was a French criminologist who invented a classification system for suspicious characters. He is the progenitor of the mugshot. So a typical Bertillon mugshot has a frontal view, in a profile view, all right? That combined with a series of measurements, which are called Bertillon measurements, and they are listed right here, okay? Now, what it would be is it would be, I think, base of the nose to the tip of the nose. This is easy to demonstrate on my head. Forehead to the back of the head. Sometimes you'll see they have a great big caliper that they're using this. Of course, height, wingspan, arm to arm. And the idea behind this is that, and what they would do then is they would take the photographs, paste them on a card, put the Bertillon measurements on the other side of the card, and then they would send them around to various what they called rogues galleries. They'd have a cabinet where these photographs would be, and if police had a suspicious character, they saw somebody that they thought might be guilty of something, they'd go to the rogues gallery and check it out. And the idea with the measurements is that the measurements would remain, you know, you can't really change your height all that easily, right? So the height and wingspan and these things would help them identify suspects even if they're in disguise or if their faces have been altered. Of course, fingerprints essentially, and now DNA, have removed the idea of the usefulness of Bertillon measurements. Now let's talk about dating for a minute. I just read an interesting article about dating in the cyber world, and I have to say that I'm thankful that I'm not dateable in this era. All right, but I have to think about it because my daughter is, and soon both of them will be. And it's a scary world out there, because how do you ever know that what you see is what you're going to get? All right. Now, what's interesting is someone told me, it's an interesting statement, when you're a parent, everything old is young again, which I've come to experience over and over again. Disney World, you know, see it for whole new eyes as a parent. It's interesting with dating, cyber dating, I think, isn't a whole lot different than it was in the old days. It's just done in a different mode, all right? And there's more information at a dater's fingertips. This is dating in 1917, and essentially it's just a different way this was done. These were done in German language. They had a newspaper in New York called the New York Review, which I believe was devoted 100% to matrimonial advertisements. And the lady on the left there is named Augusta Steinbach, and she is a 38-year-old, never married, a domestic from Germany, and she was looking for a man. And she came across two matrimonial advertisements. These are translated into English. One from a place called, one from a man named George Roloff, and the other one from Hermann Neugebauer. Now, ultimately, she decided that the one that she would go with was Hermann Neugebauer. And I want you to look very closely to the text of this advertisement. This is how predators operate. If you look very closely at what Hermann Neugebauer says, he's got some things out there. He's troweling. He's casting his net. He's baiting the hook. Specifically, income. All right. Now, I broke down the numbers. Do you know that Ford paid in 1913 $5 a day for a day's? He was paying double what everybody else was paying. What's interesting about that, though, is that, and that's what really caused Detroit to become the million-person city in 1920, were these great-paying jobs. What's interesting, though, I discovered when I researched this case, is that Ford's employees didn't get the $5 automatically. They got like $2.72. And then the other balance, $2 and whatever it happens to be, they only got as a bonus if they passed muster from Ford's sociological department. All right? Ford had something called a sociological department. And what they did is they made house calls. And they wanted to make sure that his employees were behaving. They weren't spending their paycheck on the bottle or drugs. They were taking their English classes, because the single biggest group was Germans, and they were saving, right? And if they could prove these things, then they would get their full $5 a day wage. You can imagine that intrusion. I mean, my employer comes to my door and said, you know, can I take a look at your liquor cabinet? Check out my invisible finger, right? So, but back then, that's the way it was. I did the numbers one time, and that $180 comes out to about $5 a day. Now, in reality, what these two folks are, George Roloff and Hermann Neugebauer, are in fact Helmut Schmidt. They're the same man. And he was putting matrimonial advertisements in all kinds of papers under all kinds of aliases. Oh. All right, just very fascinating. She fell head over heels in love with this fellow here. It's interesting, she wrote, they started kind of a torrid relationship through letters, which I document in The Shocking Story of Helmut Schmidt. There's a funny anecdote about this. She wrote a steamy letter to him telling him exactly how she was going to please him as a wife. And it got delivered to a Detroit shoemaker named Adam Neugebauer. And unfortunately for the poor cobbler, Mrs. Neugebauer got the mail that day. You know, boxed her husband's ears, you know, you're having an affair. So all of this in German, of course. So they called an attorney who was well-versed in German, well-known in the German community, to come and unkink it. His name was George Anthony Dondero, which is kind of a famous personage, the first Royal Oak mayor. Okay, there was a high school named after him for a while, I think. And He became a U.S. congressperson for several terms, and he wound up very heavily involved in his early life as an assistant prosecuting attorney on this case. So anyways, lonely hearts killers, people who trawl matrimonial advertisements, they're going to do things like this right here, maybe out of servant class. German society in the early days of the 20th century was very class-based. Upper class, aristocratic class did not mix with the middle classes and the domestic class. So when he says this, he says maybe out of servant class, what is he doing? He's saying, essentially, he's implying that he is from the aristocratic class. He's also sort of forecasting the fact that he has money. And she's looking for a house and a home. This is bait on the hook. And for a German domestic from a society where the upper and the lower class never mixed, that might have been just enough right there. These fiends that do this type of thing are very sharp. They're very witty when it comes to this kind of thing. There is the only known photograph of Augustus Steinbach. Very interesting story about how I came across that. I can tell you if we have some time. And this is the actual handwritten matrimonial advertisement that was sent under the name of Hermann Elgebauer. Actually, it's Helmut Schmidt. And the reason why this is significant is because of the handwriting. They matched up the handwriting with an old signature of him and, you know, proved that they were two in the same, one in the same person. Okay. Here we come to the Lonely Hearts case. The first of three cases that I'll talk in at a little bit of length today. This took place in Wyoming Township, which is special to me because I was born and raised there. It is a suburb on the near west side of Grand Rapids, Michigan. The Furniture City. And the case took place in February of 1949. Now, let's just take a quick look at what life was like in 1949. In the United States, RCA introduces the first 45 RPM record. I suspect you folks know what those are. My students would have no idea. RPM record? Well, what's that? What is RPM? What's a record? Right. President Truman begins his second term. The first TV soap opera, There Are My Children, begins its run, I believe, in Chicago. In Michigan. Michigan Congress debates the Betz-Warner electric chair bill. Michigan has never had, since statehood, a death penalty. The last person executed in Michigan was a Detroiter, a tavern owner who went on a bender one night and leveled his wife with one punch, and she must have struck the floorboards in a way that fractured her skull because he killed her. And he was hanged in Detroit. Michigan became a state not long after that. And because of the way the hanging went down, people were so turned off from the death penalty that one of the first things that they did was essentially put a ban on death penalties in Michigan. Now, in 1949, Congress had debated this issue with the Betz-Warner electric chair bill. And essentially, they were trying to decide whether the state of Michigan wanted to execute its worst felons with the electric chair. That's an important point, because when they're debating this, a pair named Beck and Fernandez come to Wyoming Township. More of that in a minute. In Grand Rapids, we have a 28-year-old woman named Delphine Downing, who, very much like Augusta Steinbach and a lot of other lonely hearts, was lonely and looking for love. She was married to a GI who died in a horrific truck accident, and she was raising their child. And at one point in time, she decided that she just didn't want to spend the rest of her life alone. So she joined a matrimonial club and started looking around for a match. And the man that she ultimately corresponded to was an affluent New Yorker named Charles Martin. There. There's a matrimonial ad, 1940s style. Why be lonely? Road to romance. Get acquainted, club. Consolidated, notice the word choice, consolidated. It's interesting use of the word in that context. You know, consolidated, come together, right? Yeah, yeah. Now, 10 years before this, a fellow named Harry Powers was going through the matrimonial clubs, and they came under a lot of scrutiny because he had dozens and dozens of victims, and several of them that he had established communications with but didn't harm were in the Detroit area. And the people who were running these matrimonial clubs just very narrowly missed criminal charges themselves. The dating clubs went on. This is the letter that the widow Downing sent to wealthy Charles Martin Dear Charles, thank you for the thoughtful Christmas greetings, and please do pay attention very carefully to the language that she is using. Put yourself in the mindset of a predator. What is she saying that might make somebody like an Arthur Warren Waite or a devious, twisted type want to court her? Dear Charles, thank you for the thoughtful Christmas greetings. Christmas was busy, but the lull afterward gives me such an empty, lonely feeling. New Year's Eve, I kept the neighbor's children so they could go out and they were sleeping peacefully. The only noise was when the dog howled at midnight. I've been having trouble with my old car. Maybe I should have bought a new one, but I hate to spend so much when it could be used for Rennell's future, their child. Do you like children, Charles? I hope you do, because if we continue to correspond, I will mention Rennell often. I have a nice two-stall garage and is still full of my husband's tools, but I am getting many things sold. I live outside the city limits in a nice section. I hope I don't break the rules of friendship correspondence by writing you before you have time to consider my last letter. Sincerely, Delphine Downing. Now, it's actually heartbreaking to read this, knowing what's going to happen to Delphine Downing, but she sends out certain clues that is going to be like glue for a guy like Charles Martin. One is she's got a car, right? 1940, she's got a car. And not only does she have a car, but she makes note of the fact that it's old and maybe I should have bought a new one. Okay, so that implies that perhaps maybe she's got a bank account enough to buy one. Then she goes on and she talks about she's got a two-stall garage. And I think in 1949, a two-stall garage was a little bit of a luxury item. And then she's got all these tools. And so, unfortunately, Charles Martin corresponded with her, and they began a relationship and more or less agreed to meet. And so Charles Martin and his sister in tow wind up on her doorstep in February of 1949. There is Charles Martin without his wig on, his toupee. He has been referred to as a Latin Lothario. A Latin Charles Boyer. Not sure I would go that far. He was born in Hawaii by the name of Raymond Fernandez before Hawaii was a state. Raymond Fernandez was fought during the Spanish Civil War. He fell in love with and married a Spanish bride, and he either was going, times were tough, he was going to come back to the United States. He told her to get a job, and maybe he was going to abandon her outright. But he hitched a ride aboard a ship coming across the Atlantic, and he was coming out through a hatch, an open hatch, when the ship hit a swell, and the hatch fell down on his head and fractured his skull right here, this frontal part. Again, easy to illustrate on my head, my nose. Right. He spent several weeks in a hospital. He recovered, but... And when he got back to the United States, he wound up living with his sister for a time in New York City. And he was reportedly to be very different. He was a very passive individual, I think, but gentle. And after the accident, he became very quick-tempered, unpredictable. And there's been a lot written about frontal head injuries and behavioral changes like that. One way or another, as soon as he got back to New York, he started going through the matrimonial advertisements, right, looking for victims. And he played a very lucrative game. He would, and for a certain set, he was considered a highly attractive individual. Right? He would correspond with women. He would meet them. I think most often than not, it became intimate. He'd rob them of everything that he could. And then he'd skip town. And a lot of these crimes went unreported because there was a tremendous amount of scrutiny attached to premarital intimacy back then. All right? So the number of victims that he had were probably in the hundreds. Right? Now, he had one victim. Get this one. You talk about a slick willy. Right? He had one victim, and what he was after was her apartment in New York City. So he established a relationship with her, and he took her to Spain. And he introduced his mistress to his wife because they were still married. Can you imagine that one? All right? As bizarre as that sounds, there is precedence for that. Helmut Schmidt introduced his current wife to his future wives as his sister. Right? Why would somebody go along with this? Complicity or fear, right? Certain people are easily dominated by other people who are kind of manipulative type Svengalis, if you know what I mean by that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that a certain personality type mixed with another personality type can really be dangerous, essentially. So anyways, the woman that he brings to introduce to his wife in Spain, they have some type of argument, and she winds up dead. And it was just assumed that she died of some type of natural causes. He comes back to the United States, and he evicts the mother of this woman who is living in her apartment, and he sets up shop in this Tony Manhattan apartment. Okay? And it's possible that he murdered that woman, although it's an unprovable thesis at this point in time. So he continues his game, and he finds a nurse in Florida, Tallahassee, who had she presented herself as being very beautiful and presented herself as being quite affluent. And he struck up a relationship. She never did send him a picture, but he went down there and saw her, and her name was Martha Beck. And he was a bit shocked when he took a look at her, and now he realized why she never sent the picture in the first place. Okay, so their relationship became intimate. He got what he could, his game, his usual game, and they went back to New York. But she had fallen head over heels in love. I mean, fell hard. This was the man of her dreams, the man that she was meant to be with. And so she showed up on his doorstep with her children. Now, Fernandez wanted nothing to do with the kids. So he agreed to let her stay if she got rid of the kids. So she took them to a Salvation Army home. She abandoned her children for love. He didn't really interested in her anyways. So when the kids were gone, Raymond Fernandez had a heart-to-heart with Martha Beck, and he said, listen, sweetheart, I'm really using matrimonial advertisements to rob people, all right? And she's like, okay, well, you know what? If you present me as your sister, we can work the scheme more efficiently because reluctant women, you know, give credibility. Reluctant women won't be so reluctant if you show up with your sister. So I'll be your sister, Charles Martin's sister. Okay, so the pair wind up in Wyoming Township. Now, the funny thing, now, on their devious journey between New York and Wyoming Township, they had met several individuals and worked their game. One of them was a New Yorker named Janet Fay, who, there's a lot of theories about what went on with this particular case. Janet Fay died of a hammer blow to the head, okay? And how Martha Beck presented it to the world is that Raymond Fernandez got in, they had a rule for their game. He could defraud women, but he couldn't sleep with them. And so the way the case played out is whenever he got intimate with a victim, she went into a murderous rage, and she went after Janet Fay with a hammer, right? And ultimately, I think she also, it didn't happen right away. She didn't die right away. I think she might have started to seize, because what happens with people with that kind of a head injury is they'll have a seizure. So she wound up garroting her, do you know what I mean, with a handkerchief and turning her out that way. So there were a couple of instances where Raymond Fernandez married, or bigamously, because he was still married to his Spanish wife, or became intimate with women, and Martha Beck, just as the story goes, went into a murderous rage. Now, you've seen what Martha Beck looks like. So they come to Wyoming Township, and he's got this radiantly beautiful brunette, Delphine Downing. And pretty soon, they wind up intimate, and Martha Beck can't handle it. So, Martha Beck coerces, as the story goes, Raymond Fernandez into, Martha Beck was a trained nurse. So the first thing they try to do with Delphine Downing is feed her a bunch of phenobarbital tablets. But it didn't kill her. So she coerces Raymond Fernandez to shoot Delphine Downing in the head with her husband's service revolver, .45, with Rennell in the room. Okay. Now, they took the body to the basement. And I can show you the house if you were so morbidly inclined, because it still exists. And he had already bought plaster for this purpose. And they create sort of a makeshift grave. They dig a hole. Now, Wyoming Township has a real high water table. You dig down a foot, you're into a puddle, all right? So here you got this pair with this Rennell, and the baby is screaming, you know. And you got one bailing out the hole with a bucket, and the other's digging, right? And they truss up Delphine Downing, and they bury her. But then there's the kid, and they don't know what to do with the kid. And neither one of them really wants to murder the child. So they drive around for a little while, try to figure it out. They go to the movie and take the daughter to the movies. And somewhere along the way, Martha Beck decides that the child has to go. She's too much of a liability to their scam. They had talked for a while that maybe they would sort of semi-adopt the child, but they thought that Fernandez's relatives in New York would start asking questions. How come he just showed up with a kid all of a sudden? So Martha Beck took the child to the basement, that pail of muddy water. She held the ankles like this and shoved the head in like that. All right, there's one version of the story has Raymond Fernandez can't stand the sight of it, so he runs up the stairs, and she's sort of like, you know, she chastises him. What are you, weak-kneed? What's your problem? You know, she drowned the baby. So they took the baby and put it into a military-style footlocker. They jackknifed it with wire, and then they buried it in the same hole and then paved it over. Now, Delphine Downing was missed. She had close family relationship with her husband's relatives, and they hadn't heard from her for a while, and so they called the township and the Kent County authorities, and four police officers showed up on the door. It was also suspicious that there was a car with New York license plates parked there. So they decided to execute a search. They find on Raymond Fernandez a big, huge wad of banknotes, which it turns out was the remainder of Delphine Downing's life savings, because he had her go and liquidate her her bank accounts before he killed her. They found that Beck and Fernandez had packed up a whole bunch of Delphine Downing's things that they were going to take with her. And what I find very interesting is that Martha Beck wanted the pulp novels. So they found a whole suitcase of Delphine Downing's novels. And it's an interesting piece of evidence, because what did people do with their books back in the day? They wrote their names in them, right? What is this doing in Martha Beck's luggage? She's going to steal it, right? There are the four officers there, and they're looking over the grave. They dug down. They broke the concrete, and they dug down a little bit, and there they found Delphine Downing. And so Raymond Fernandez and Martha Beck are in the house when they find the body. They are caught. They are caught red-handed. They're brought to the Grand Rapids Police Station, and they're questioned. And the police saw this when they dug up the hole. They saw this little military footlocker, and they didn't think anything about it, so they put it to the side. All right. Now, when Beck and Fernandez got to the police station, they were asked immediately what happened to the child. And at that point in time, Fernandez knew that his game was up. So he said, it's in the little green box. They go back and they find the body. Now it gets kind of interesting. Beck and Fernandez are in a state that doesn't have capital punishment. Life is 20 years with the possibility of parole. Today they have a never-never list. John Norman Collins is on the never-never list. He'd never come out, all right, ever. All right. But back then, 20 years with the possibility of parole. Mary McKnight, for all those murders she committed, I think she was in prison for 17 years. All right. And then she was paroled. All right. So it's a different world than it is today. So they were offered a deal. If you tell us every single detail of every crime that you have committed, we will not extradite you to the state of New York, where you're wanted for the murder of Janet Fay. And guess what? New York has Old Sparky, which is colloquial for the electric chair. Now, remember that little table of contents I had, what was going on in Michigan at the time in 1949? The Congress was debating the Getz-Warner electric chair bill. So the prosecutor played a little switcheroo on him. As soon as that bill failed in Congress, he extradited him to New York along with their full confession, including details of how they killed Janet Fay. So the pair went on to New York for a trial. Here is Raymond Fernandez confessing, and look at the fabulous police tunic that fellow is in, all right? You know what's interesting about this is when I look at a photograph like this, I would automatically conclude that the fellow with the suit on is a more important officer, right, because he's in plain clothes. And that may be how it is today. I mean, the detective's in plain clothes. But back then, that suit cost $80, all right? So in order to be a township officer, you didn't get the suit right away. They gave you a car, they gave you a gun. And if you proved yourself, then you got the $80 suit, right? Fabulous. Clarence Randall is his name. And there's Raymond Fernandez. Now, one theory about why they killed Delphine Downing is because he had this ugly scar right here, and he had covered it up with a toupee, and she walked in on him in the bathroom, and he didn't have it on, and she immediately flew into a rage about him lying to her, right? And but I don't believe that to be fact. Got to keep in mind that the confession is coming from the people who committed the crimes. Here's Martha Beck. Now, I do feel a little bit bad for Martha Beck because she may not have been as guilty as she made herself feel. There is some evidence that she overacted her part in the crime so she could protect the love of her life. In other words, she was literally willing to take a bullet or go to the chair to get Raymond off the hook. He might have been a little more culpable than she let on. One way or another, I mean, they were in it together. But Martha Beck was always depicted as, the press had a field day with her weight. The headline that went along with this caption in the Grand Rapids Herald was, Martha Beck confesses, ... then eats. Okay, and that's a very typical of the kind of coverage that she got. Yeah, Martha Beck confesses, then eats. Okay, here is part of their confession. Again, the word choice is interesting. Fernandez asked me if I had enough sleeping pills to put her out of the way for good. I thought I had. I had 14 1.5 grain phenobarbital pills. She took them and quickly became drowsy and fell asleep in the back bedroom. At about 6 p.m., she became restless and apparently wanted to wake up but just couldn't. Raymond said I had better shoot her. He took a gun, wrapped it up in 2 baby blankets, and shot her. Now, look at this last sentence. She is describing the murder of an infant. All right? The baby struggled so much I could hardly hold her, so I wrapped it in a blanket and held it all the way under for 15 or 20 minutes. What's interesting about this, from an English standpoint, is notice the mixture of pronouns here. And Mary McKnight, who made a similar confession, did the exact same thing. Her, and then again, it. Personal pronoun, and then objectified. I wonder if that's a way that in their own mind, they tend to sort of cope with the idea that they've committed this horrific thing, this horrific act. Or scarier, they see the baby as a thing and not a person. I mean, that's, you know, there's all kinds of possibilities. There's a lot of unanswered questions about this case. We have to be careful with serial killers because lots of times the public will immediately jump to conclusions. And nothing could be truer than this case as far as that's concerned. When Raymond Fernandez was found, they found a list of names in his pocket and it was well over 100 long. And the public assumed, newspaper reporters assumed that they would find 100 bodies buried in concrete underneath cellars and places. Okay. Now, they had found all these women alive. These were merely women that he had planned to contact in the future. I mean, this was the extent of his scam. But the newspapers, nonetheless, proclaimed that he had like 140 victims. Now, in reality, I think they probably had 4, right? But these lies, these misconceptions get perpetuated. We had a very tragic instance of a mass murder in Grand Rapids a few years ago. A guy kind of went on a shooting rage and killed a bunch of people, and the Grand Rapids newspaper ran an article where they listed the worst mass murderers in Michigan, in Grand Rapids history, and one right at the top of the list was Beck and Fernandez, and the reporter had written responsible for possibly 24 victims. And that came from that list. That there's no evidence that they killed anybody any more than 4. Not that there's a, you know, 4 is as bad as 20, you know what I mean? I don't want to, you know, downplay it, but sometimes these things, myth takes over. Okay, John Norman Collins. Good looking guy? I don't know. You decide. All right. I think that John Norman Collins is very much like Arthur Warren Waite. I think they're kind of similar looking. Also similar to Raymond Fernandez, in that they're very good looking guys who are very personable. Charismatic would be the word that I would use to describe them, but you really don't know what's going on inside. Right? He was known as the Ypsilanti Strangler in his late 60s when he was active. Interesting case. List of his victims. Now again, I have to preface this with the fact that John Norman Collins was convicted and is serving a life sentence for one murder. Did he kill these others? The evidence is that, yeah, except for this one right here, in which case somebody else was convicted. The first victim, they were all females, all young. All of them had been subjected to some type of a mutilation, antemortem or paramortem mutilation, before the death or after the death. So there was a similar MO. This first victim was Mary Flazar, and the connection with Collins is kind of an interesting one. A young guy shows up at the funeral home to photograph the body. And he's never that young man was never positively identified as Collins, but police think that he actually was. And I guess serial killers will do this. They'll go and sometimes show up in public places to sort of inspect their work, so to speak. Second one, Joan Schell. Now, this is there's a direct connection with John Norman Collins. She went on a date with him, and she was last known to be with him, last seen with him. And he told police that he had an alibi. He was with his mother in Centerline at the time that the crime took place. They took him for his word, right? A few months later, there's Jane Mixer, who is a student at the University of Michigan, was found in a place called Denton Cemetery. Interesting, a murder victim being deposited in a cemetery. I mean, how many layers of irony do you have there? And there's no overt connection to John Norman Collins at all, right? We'll come back to that in a minute. March 26, 1969. Now, Jane Mixer, Marilyn Skelton, Don Bassam, and Alice Kalam were killed within such a tight period of time that it caused a hysteria. And I wasn't around at the time, but I understand that co-eds were like terrified and didn't even want to go out unescorted by males because of all this, right? Marilyn Skelton, her connection to Collins was she was last seen in an apartment that was rented by a friend of Collins, and he frequented it often, so they had a connection there. April 15th, Dawn Bassam, who was 13 years old, she was a middle school student, horrific mutilation, injuries to the body. She was known to be, she was last seen on a dirt road when he was known to ride his motorcycle. Now, when police investigated John Norman Collins, they discovered that most of the parts that he was using for fixing up his motorcycle were stolen. And I think if you look at serial killers, if you really take them apart and look at them as a group, you'll find that theft almost always precedes murder, which is kind of interesting. And he was a long, long rap sheet of thefts. June 8th, 1969, Alice Kalam, last seen at a party, unclear connection to Collins. And then the police find the body of Karen Sue Beineman. Now, again, horrific anti and paramortem mutilations. And I don't want to get into specifics because it's really gross and kind of somewhat nasty. But she was last seen with a guy matching Collins' description. She and a man on a motorcycle stopped at a wig shop. And the person who was running the wig shop was able to later identify John Norman Collins as the guy who was riding the motorcycle. Because they had already questioned him in connection with Joan Schell, Joan Schell's murder, now all of a sudden he became the focus of an investigation of a serial killer. And of course the press then immediately convicted him of all of these murders, every single one of them, and others. It seems like if there's been a co-ed of a certain age missing in the late 60s, Collins is always the one that seems to get tagged for it, whether he did it or not. He may have. Now, while they're investigating the murder of Karen Sue Beineman, the California police start investigating a murder there. And so you have an investigation taking place in two different states. And the California cops came and they took a look at a sweater. The body of the victim was found in a ravine. And the theory is that the killer put the body over his shoulder like this and carried her from the car to the ravine. The body was found nude. When they looked at John Norman Collins' closet, they found a sweater, and the sweater was loaded with hairs. That they didn't have DNA testing back then, but they matched the hairs to the victim in California. So this led to a little bit of a scruff between California authorities and Michigan authorities as to who exactly was going to get John Norman Collins. And it's kind of interesting because had he been extradited to California and they had a pretty good case against him, there's a chance that he could have wound up going to the gas chamber. Because California, again, unlike Michigan, is a death penalty state. They had, Collins was house-sitting for a police officer when Karen Beineman went missing, and they found all kinds of physical evidence tying Beineman to the basement of that house where he had tortured her before he had killed her. So the forensics case against John Norman Collins was really, really strong. And then, of course, the identification from the wig shop owner just sealed the deal. Now, there is a book written about this case, and it's the writer is brilliant. It's called The Michigan Murders. Anybody? Read it? Anybody? Michigan Murders? Okay. The author, Edward Keyes, very brilliant writer, but they say that his one misstep was that he based his book on press reports, and essentially it became a bestseller in Michigan. People assumed what he was saying was fact. This was the string of Collins' victims. In at least one instance, he was not guilty. This case here, this Jane Mixer, this one right here, the one found in the cemetery, she was in fact murdered by a man named Leiterman, who was later put on trial and convicted of her murder. All right. So there's at least one instance where these aren't all his victims. Police like him for all these others. Now, if you want to read about this particular case, you could get My True Crime Michigan. There's another book out there that's very little known. It's kind of hard to get your hands on, but it's by a former Michigan State Police investigator who was involved in this case, and it's called Catching Serial Killers. If you your library can get it for you through interlibrary loan. I can't tell you who the publisher is, but it's Catching Serial Killers. And in the preface to the book, the writer says the whole purpose of him writing this was to set the record straight about John Norman Collins. Of course, he doesn't just talk about Collins. He talks about, like, the Boston Strangler and some others. But there's evidence that he had access to that the public didn't know about. For instance, I understand that there was a rape victim who was going to come forward and testify that Collins raped her, but they didn't use her at the trial. And there's all kinds of evidence, and he goes victim by victim. Is it what the police were thinking, how the investigation worked, and what the evidence was. So if you're interested in Collins, you might want to check that out. He is serving life at Marquette State Penitentiary, and you want to go check him out. We are an open state with our records, so there is a website called OTIS, which is Offender Tracking and Information System, OTIS. And if you type in his name, you'll see his current mugshot. Big bodybuilder. Okay. I think he tried to escape from prison at one point in time. Do you all not know about OTIS? Have you not heard about that before? You've heard about the sex offender list? Okay. OTIS is your gateway to the sex offender list, too. And I've only done it once because it really scared me and it was disturbing. But I typed in my zip code, and they'll list all the sex offenders in your area. And that was a little bit too eye-opening for me, to be honest with you. But anyways, anybody who's incarcerated, pardon me? I want to think that John Norman Collins is 60. Okay, I want to think he's 60 right now. And I thought I just read that someplace, but don't quote me on that. But if you like to walk on the dark side and you're interested in these things, you can access these mugshots online and you can find the crimes and some really, really interesting individuals. All right. Now, originally I had a photograph, which is perfect Hoffa, where he's doing this. But given that I'm being on TV and copyright status and all that fun stuff, I replaced it with this one from the Library of Congress. Jimmy Hoffa is probably, I would say, there's what, three or four of the most infamous missing persons cases in U.S. history. He's right up there. You've got Amelia Earhart, Jimmy Hoffa, Judge Joseph Force Crater from New York City. Feel like I'm missing somebody kind of big. So we have Jimmy Hoffa. Now, very fascinating individual, no matter what you might have heard about him. When I wrote the chapter, I gained a lot of respect for what Hoffa did with organized labor. Somewhere along the line, it went kind of bad for him, but he was raised in some of these itinerant coal mining villages. His dad died of something called black lung. And the mom, Viola, rolled up her sleeves and went to work cleaning the clothes of these miners. And that was young Jimmy's playground. And I think that was the Roaring Twenties. A lot of these Midwestern coal towns were sort of at the epicenter of prohibition breaking, all right? And that was his playground. Eventually, Viola came up to the boom town, the Midwest boom town, and that was Detroit. And I think that coincided with the million person mark, all these high-paying jobs in Detroit. And he went on to do some really important things for organized labor. He led a group called the Strawberry Boys, and I think they got their name because some strawberries came into a store and they decided that was the time to go on strike to get better conditions. And if they didn't settle quickly, the strawberries would rot. So sometimes they refer to the Strawberry Boys. Hoffa became kind of a emperor to his own right. And he sat on top of a vast amount of money that was the Teamster Pension Fund. And I don't know exactly how much was this money was used under he and his successor to give low-interest loans to some people who went to build Las Vegas, all right? A lot of Las Vegas was built with low-interest loans from the Teamster Pension Fund, and you know all the mob connections with Las Vegas, right? Now, at one point in time, Jimmy Hoffa went to jail, and a guy named Frank Fitzsimmons took over. And I guess Fitzsimmons was really loose with that Teamster pension fund. And the theory goes is that when Hoffa came out of prison, he wanted to turn it all around. He was tired of the bad rap the Teamsters had gotten, and he didn't want to have organized ties with organized crime anymore. But these crime bosses were so dependent on the low interest loans that his coming back was a direct threat to them. So they got rid of him. Last seen in August, I don't know if I have the date on here exactly. It's August 1975 in a Bloomfield Hills restaurant. The Red Fox. Seen getting into a car with three other people. And that's the last anybody has ever seen of Jimmy Hoffa. They found a single hair. That's all that has ever been found of Hoffa. And every now and again, they churn up a lead, and they're still looking. And the reason why they're never going to find him is because Jimmy Hoffa isn't dead. He's had a sex change, and he's working... He's, according to a National Enquirer paper, he's had a sex change and he's actually working as a stripper in Las Vegas. I thought about putting that into the chapter. I'm kidding. When I wrote it, sometimes serendipity when you're a writer, you know, the funniest things come up. I was writing a chapter about Jimmy Hoffa and I was going through Family Fair and there was one of those scandal sheets my grandmother used to call them, Star, you know, one of those. And there it is, big headline, Jimmy Hoffa's alive. You know, so those of you, The FBI's investigation on this is called the Hoffex Memo, yeah. And it is available online, and you can find it and print it. The reason why it's even in existence at all is because Hoffa's daughter was a district court judge, I think, and the FBI didn't want to release their file, and she pushed a little bit, and the file got released. And the original version of it had a whole bunch of names blackened out like that, but now you can get it unexpurgated, and you can find it. It's really interesting. It's like a Goodfellas. Is laid out in cast of characters, local cast of characters, characters from Delaware, you know, all these mob figures and such. Now, not long ago, a mob hitman who was dying, I think, of cancer from Delaware named Sheeran came forward and said, I did it, I killed him, I shot him. We picked him up. There was the driver, a cleaner, myself, and these people were well known to Hoffa because he was known to be kind of paranoid, rightfully so, it appears. And they picked him up and they drove him to a house on a place called Beaverland Avenue or Beaverland Drive. And as soon as he got in the door, they shot him in the back of the head. They took him right to a mortuary and had him cremated, which if you think about it is really, it fits why they wouldn't find any remains. They found a single hair in the car, right? So the problem with the confession is that this had been preceded by, it became kind of a camp industry for killers on incarcerated in prison to sort of confess to Hoffa. I don't know if it was like a badge of honor, like I killed Hoffa too, you know, along with it. And it had been one after another, a couple of them wrote books about their crimes. And so when Sheeran came along, I think that people looked at it with a great deal of skepticism. The police went off to the house at Beaverland Drive or Avenue, and they took up some carpet and they found some blood stains on the floorboards. Now, I think the FBI not long after that came out and said that the DNA did not match Hoffa's, and so the case goes on. All I will say about that on camera is this. First of all, the mob had a pretty good set of cleaners, okay? Second of all, it's not necessarily, just because you have dried blood from 40 years ago, it's not necessarily a given that you can even get mitochondrial DNA from that, all right? So, wouldn't it be interesting if that is in fact the truth, but they can't find enough evidence, the case will go on in perpetuity, but in essence, it could have been solved already. And then again, Sheeran might have been lying, although his motives for doing that would be really, really extremely hard to understand. I was doing a book signing at a Barnes & Noble, and a lady came up to me from Detroit. She told me a story that Jimmy Hoffa is, as the saying goes, standing and he's facing east. And she told me that about right after the time he disappeared, there was some cement footings that were being poured for a building in Detroit. And he got poured into the footing facing east, which is kind of interesting. I know they took all kinds of radar detection equipment over to Giant Stadium in the Meadowlands because it was, you know, one killer claimed that he buried him there and they never found anything. They tore up a farm or a field not long ago looking for Hoffa. And he's another theory is that he was gator bait. They threw him in a swamp and he got eaten by alligators, which is really kind of interesting. What's that?
Northern alligators.
Yeah, well, you know, they have to, you know, And my wife and I were just talking about this. I mean, he could have been dumped in an ocean. You've heard about that unfortunate situation about those two boys?
Yeah.
They have not found anything yet, have they?
No.
You know, when a person drowns, more often than not, they sink. And the heaviest thing on your body is your head. It's about the size, about the weight of a bowling ball. And so human beings, when they sink, they assume kind of like a whale song position with the head and arms forward like this. And then the decomposition process causes the body to bloat and float. They call them floaters in the medical community. And we were talking about that. And I said to my wife, if these boys did in fact drown and they went underwater, it is possible that they may never be found, right? That, because there are things in the ocean that have teeth, right? I hope that's not the case. I mean, ideally you'd love it that, you know, tomorrow's headline is, boys are found, you know, they're in good shape, they're dehydrated, but they've learned not to go out, you know, that far. But tragically, that's probably not the way that's going to play out. But and this is kind of an interesting tidbit, and I'll kind of leave with this because I'm running over a little bit. In the Great Lakes, you know what causes the bloating and floating process to be set back is cold water. Mm-hmm. All right. So in the Great Lakes, if a body goes down in cold water, it may never come up. Mm-hmm. You know, Dr. Cole, my co-author for my first two books, he told me that there could very well be sort of like a, I like to think of them as like a mer population, you know, of various states of decomposition in the bottom of the lakes because the water is so cold, they just never came up. Right? It's kind of fascinating.
He said the water in Florida was 82 degrees, so that's why they don't want to give up any hope of either the body getting found.
Yeah, because that would be awfully hard to freeze to death in that kind of water. I don't even know if you could, theoretically. So hopefully they will be found. That would be miraculous, but that would be wonderful, wouldn't it? Give you faith in the goodness of the world. All right, you want to talk crime sometime, you can get a hold of me. This is my email address. I love to hear from people. Please do. If there was something that you saw or heard today that you would like to have further discussion, or if you know of a book club or a library that would like to come and host me, I would be more than happy. I love Troy. I've got a crush on Troy. I've spoken at the library a couple times. You folks are always really, really good to me. I have a presentation devoted to every single one of these books that talks about each of the cases in detail, including the Civil War. And if you really want to go inside a morgue, I can't take you into one, but I can do the next best thing, and I can show you through my experience what took place in there. I have a presentation then as well. You can follow me on Facebook. I'll update that with places that I'm going to be. I don't think I'm going to be back now in this neck of the woods for a little while yet, but there'll be some in 16. And if you want to check out some of the discoveries that I've made as a crime researcher, some of the darker corners of history, the boxer from Grand Rapids who killed another guy and almost got charged for murder, or the case of the stolen horse and buggy from Jackson in the 1870s is kind of a fascinating one. Stuff that wouldn't really make a book, but is fabulous and fabulously interesting. You'll find that stuff in dark corners of history. So, let me say again, thank you so much. And thank you. Thank you. Are there any questions that I can answer? Yes, ma'am.
Isn't that Beaverland Avenue? Is that in Detroit?
I think it's in Bloomfield Hills.
Okay.
I think it's like a mile or two away, I think. Yes, ma'am. And I'm glad you said that because I was thinking 1975, 2015, that's 40.
Yeah.
And it is actually today.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Serendipity.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you just say real quickly something about the Purple Gang in the 1930s?
Yeah. What's interesting about the Purple Gang is there's a kind of a connection to Clare, Michigan. There is a hotel in Clare called the Doherty.
Yep. Yeah.
I don't think it was always called the Doherty, but I think that some of the Purple Gang actually went there to cool down from time to time. Was it the Doherty for a long time? The Purple Gang was run by four brothers named Bernstein, and essentially it was they were kind of ruthless overlords of a smaller network of gangs, and they imploded in a gang war where they had some people killed, and they all went down one after another. The one went legit and invested his money in oil wells around Clare, which is kind of interesting. So. One of the men, this is an interesting connection, but one of the men who was profiting from the Teamsters' credit, Teamsters' pension, was a hoodlum from Cleveland, and he was a former Purple Gang member. And he went on to be one of the architects of Las Vegas, which I personally love, so I don't want to sit here and bash it, but... Yes, ma'am. You're not the first person to ask me that. I have had a lot of people ask me that. Yeah. Whenever there's plenty of stuff to write about. Whenever I start peeling up rocks, I find three more cases I want to write about. And that's one of them. The issue really becomes time for me at this point in time, because I am a father of two young children, and I have a day job, and so I have to parse out my time is kind of... But that may very well be a future project of mine. Yeah. Yeah, in which case that case would be interesting too, because I could put it together with people who were alive at the time. Most of the time I'm dealing with folks who are so, I mean, they're really dead, right? So, any other questions? Yes, sir.
About 81 years ago, and I think it was today or yesterday, they shot John Dillinger at the Biograph Theater in Chicago.
Yep. Interesting tidbit about that one. His eyes were different colors when they did the autopsy. And so that led to a whole host of conspiracy theories that Dillinger didn't actually get shot at the Biograph, that the lady in red turned in somebody else and it was a lookalike. Here's an interesting thing, though. Post-mortem, the eye color changes. Yeah, that can be a post-mortem effect of decomposition. Yeah, yeah. It's kind of fascinating. I was on Wood TV on a show called 8 West at... 11 o'clock Tuesday. Is it a Wood TV affiliate?
It's WDIV.
Could be. I mean, does it look like me? hairless? What was I talking about? No, that wasn't me then. Oh, it must have been my double. How scary is that? Anybody else? Questions? Okay, well, if you'd like to buy a book or you just want to shake my hand or say hello, come on up. Yeah.